What you had just listened to was the wonderful guitar playing and singing skills by none other than legendary Delta Blues musical artist Robert Leroy Johnson. Robert Johnson was an American blues guitarist, singer, and songwriter. His landmark recordings in 1936 and 1937 display a combination of singing, guitar skills, and songwriting talent that has influenced later generations of musicians. He is now recognized as a master of the blues, particularly the Delta blues style. According to legend, as a young man living on a plantation in rural Mississippi, Johnson had a tremendous desire to become a great blues musician. One of the legends often told says that Johnson was instructed to take his guitar to a crossroads near Dockery Plantation at midnight. There are claims for at least a dozen other sites as the location of the crossroads. There, he was met by a large black man who took the guitar and tuned it. The devil played a few songs and then returned the guitar to Johnson, giving him mastery of the instrument. This story of a deal with the devil at the crossroads mirrors the legend of Faust. In exchange for his soul, Johnson was able to create the blues for which he became famous for. This legend was developed over time and has been chronicled by Gail Dean Wardlow, Edward Camora, and Elijah Wald, who sees the legend as largely dating from Johnson's rediscovery by white fans more than two decades after his death. Son House once told the story to Pete Welding as an explanation of Johnson's astonishingly rapid mastery of the guitar. Welding reported it as a serious belief in a widely read article in Downbeat in 1966. Other interviewers failed to elicit any confirmation from House, and there were fully 2 years between House's observation of Johnson as first a novice and then a master. Further details were absorbed from the imaginative retellings by Grail Marcus and Robert Palmer. Most significantly, the detail was added that Johnson received his gift from a large black man at a crossroads. There is dispute as to how and when the crossroads detail was attached to the Robert Johnson story. All the published evidence, including a full chapter on the subject in the biography Crossroads by Tom Graves, suggests an origin in the story of the blues musician Tommy Johnson. This story was collected from his musical associate Ishman Bracey and his elder brother Liddell in the 1960s. One version of Liddell Johnson's account was published in David Even's 1971 biography of Tommy Johnson, and was repeated in print in 1982, alongside House's story in the widely read Searching for Robert Johnson by Peter Gorlonick. Further details were absorbed from the imaginative retellings by Grail Marcus and Robert Palmer. Most significantly, the detail was added that Johnson received his gift from a large black man at a crossroads. There is dispute as to how and when the crossroads detail was attached to the Robert Johnson story. All the published evidence, including a full chapter on the subject in the biography Crossroads by Tom Graves, suggests an origin in the story of the blues musician Tommy Johnson. This story was collected from his musical associate Ishman Bracey and his elder brother Liddell in the 1960s. One version of Liddell Johnson's account was published in David Evans' 1971 biography of Tommy Johnson, and was repeated in print in 1982 alongside House's story in the widely read Searching for Robert Johnson by Peter Gorlnik. In another version, Liddell placed the meeting not at a crossroads, but in a graveyard. This resembles the story told to Steve Levere that Ike Zimmerman of Hazelhurst, Mississippi, learned to play the guitar at midnight while sitting on tombstones. Zimmerman is believed to have influenced the playing of the young Robert Johnson. Recent research of the blues by scholar Bruce Conforth in Living Blues magazine makes the story clearer. Johnson and Ike Zimmerman did practice in a graveyard at night because it was quiet and no one would disturb them. But it was not the Hazelhurst Cemetery as had been believed. Zimmerman was not from Hazelhurst, but nearby Beauregard, and he did not practice in one graveyard, but in several in the area. Johnson spent about a year living with and learning from Zimmerman, who ultimately accompanied Johnson back to the Delta to look after him. While Dockery, Hazelhurst, and Beauregard have each been claimed as the locations of the mythical crossroads, there are also tourist attractions claiming to be the crossroads in both Clarksdale and Memphis. Residents of Rosedale, Mississippi claim Johnson sold his soul to the devil at the intersection of Highways 1 and 8 in their town, while the 1986 movie Crossroads was filmed in Belleau, Mississippi. The blues historian Steve Cheeseborough wrote that it may be impossible to discover the exact location of the mythical crossroads because Robert Johnson was a rambling guy. Some scholars have argued that the devil in these songs may refer not only to the Christian figure of Satan, but also to the trickster god of African origin, Legba, himself associated with crossroads. Folklorist Harry M. Hyatt wrote that during his research in the South from 1935 to 1939, when African Americans born in the 19th or early 20th centuries said they or anyone else had sold their soul to the devil at the crossroads, they had a different meaning in mind. Hyatt claimed there was evidence indicating African religious retentions surrounding Legba and the making of a deal, not selling the soul in the same sense as in the Faustian tradition, cited by Graves, with the so-called devil at the crossroads. The blues and the blues singer has really special powers over women. Especially, it is said that the blues singer could possess women and have any woman they wanted. And so, when Robert Johnson came back, having left his community as an apparently mediocre musician, with a clear genius in his guitar style and lyrics, people said he must have sold his soul to the devil. And that fits in with this old African association with the crossroads, where you find wisdom, you go down to the crossroads to learn. And in his case, to learn in a Faustian pact with the devil. You sell your soul to become the greatest musician in history. This view that the devil in Johnson's songs is derived from an African deity was disputed by the blues scholar David Evans. In an essay published in 1999, Demythologizing the Blues, there are several serious problems with this crossroads myth. The devil imagery found in the blues is thoroughly familiar with Western folklore, and nowhere do blues singers ever mention Legba or any other African deity in their songs or other lore. The actual African music connected with cults of Legba and similar trickster deities sounds nothing like the blues, but rather features polyrhythmic percussion and choral call and response singing. The musicologist Alan Lomax dismissed the myth, stating, in fact, every blues fiddler, banjo picker, harp blower, piano strummer, and guitar framer was, in the opinion of both himself and his peers, a child of the devil, a consequence of the black view of the European dance embrace as sinful in the extreme. This was not the only legend in Robert's life. After Robert Johnson died in 1938, many people began to theorize on what could have killed him. The most likely candidate would be a case of untreated syphilis. However, there are more interesting theories, one being the devil coming to collect his payment. Another suggests he was murdered. According to the latter's legend, Robert Johnson was performing at a juke joint where he began flirting with a woman who was married to a jealous man. So jealous, in fact, that he gave Johnson an alcohol beverage that was poisoned, which, according to one account, was slapped out of Johnson's hand, only for Johnson to turn to the other musician standing next to him, saying, "Don't you ever slap a bottle out of my hand." Thus, the man gave him another alcohol beverage, which he once again poisoned. It is most likely that the syphilis one seems to be the most truthful. I'm only saying this due to the fact that syphilis at that time period, and especially in the region of where this man lived, was very, very expensive and very, very hard to actually treat. It would have even been even worse due to the fact that he was an African American in a very racist time period, thus making it far more unlikely that he would have gotten this thing treated or even have known that he even had this disease. Many scholars have actually debated on the murder one, stating that there is almost no possibility or any evidence whatsoever that this actually had happened, other than a confession that someone made in a private room with this with the so-called killer, only to basically refuse to give the man's name. So, therefore, it's most likely he died of syphilis. It should also be noted at this point as well that Robert Johnson died at the age of 27, thus making him the first member of the infamous 27 Club. Yes, that's right. He was the first. And to think, Robert Johnson wasn't well known or famous in his lifetime outside of the circle of musicians that he knew. But his influences carried onward thanks to a country music producer who discovered him years later and tried to use some of his work, as well as tried to contact him, only to find out that, well, he died in 1938. So, with that, I hope you have enjoyed this episode. If you enjoyed this and would like to hear more stories like these, please go to www.youtube.com/thevoiceofnightmares. Don't forget to give my video a like, leave a comment, and subscribe for more content. Also, you can follow me now on social media sites such as Twitter, Mr. Creepypasta Amino, Creepypasta Amino, Creepypasta Wiki, and Instagram. Last but not least, all stories, art, and music are owned by their respective authors. Links are available in the description below.